Hello everyone, I am Bob and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining channel. In this build series episode, I'm going to catch you up on my setup, including uncovering the one component in my build that caused my system to overheat. So with that, let's get started. Okay, so to catch you up on my build, I started with a custom-made plastic immersion tank to hold and cool my miners. When I built this tank, I picked the wrong material, and after 3 days of mining, the tank fittings got soft, deformed, and leaked. This ended my mining until I got my hands on a DCX Bitpod system. Now, I did a review video on the Bitpod system. I have a link above to that video, and I think it's a great option for Bitcoin mining at home and something you should consider if you're interested in home mining and using Bitcoin to heat your house. When I rebuilt my mining setup with the Bitpod system, I decided to use the Bitpod tank but stayed with my existing custom-built dry cooler design, thinking this was the easiest way to get everything back up and running. However, after rebuilding and then restarting my system with this new tank, I found I couldn't run both of my S19 miners at the same time. The heat generated by the miners would build up in the tank, overheat my miners, and at least one miner would shut down. This was really frustrating and confusing because the Bitpod system is rated for over 15 kilowatts of heat dissipation, and my custom dry cooler worked fine for the 3 days my system was operational. I covered all of this in my last tank build video, where I tried a bunch of different things to figure out what was going wrong. And at the end of that video, I was thinking that the cause of my overheating was the difference in heat exchanger design between my setup and the DCX system. I had made the decision to tear apart the Bitpod tank, replacing the pump and heat exchanger and replacing them with equipment from my original design that worked with my custom-built dry cooler. Now, I wasn't really excited about this decision. DCX builds these systems in a way so they will not leak, and I was really worried that I wouldn't be able to rebuild my system without having leak problems. But at the time, it seemed like the right call, so that's what I did. Now, it turns out that removing the pump and heat exchanger was actually pretty easy. First, there's a white metal plate you have to remove. There's two screws that hold that on. You remove those two screws and the plate comes right off. And after that, there are two threaded fittings you have to remove. One connecting the pump to the hot coolant recovery, and one connecting the heat exchanger to the inlet to the tank. It just took a pair of locking pliers and a little pressure, and the whole entire assembly comes off as one piece. And this was great because I didn't have to disassemble any of the other fittings. If I want to reuse the pump and heat exchanger, I can take the whole assembly and just reattach it. Now, after removing the assembly, I could put it on the floor and compare it to my heat exchanger, and it turns out these are almost the same size. Now, on the one hand, that gave me a lot of confidence that my original design was pretty good and that my heat exchanger was the same size as the DCX heat exchanger. On the other hand, this kind of confused me in that if they're the same size, this might not be the cause of my system overheating. But since I had everything disassembled and I had all the parts to rebuild my system, I decided to proceed and rebuild the whole system. Now, in this rebuild, I decided to do things a little different, and hopefully this will give you another example of how to build your own system. In this build, I decided to go with Schedule 80C PVC instead of Schedule 40 as in the last build. I did this because, number one, I needed 1-inch fittings. I wanted to make sure there wasn't going to be any flow restrictions. And secondly, there are just so many different fittings available in the Schedule 80 design. Now, Schedule 80 does cost a little more, but I'm really happy in how it turned out. And now that I've done both a Schedule 80 and a Schedule 40 design, I really do recommend using the Schedule 80 pipe. It's more expensive, but I really think you'll be more happy with your build if you use it. Stepping behind the camera to walk you through the build, starting off at the hot coolant outlet, I have a stainless steel bulkhead fitting. This feeds into a T-fitting, which holds my thermal switch, which is part of my control system. Below that is an elbow and another T-fitting, which holds a thermal well, which will enable me to measure the temperature of the fluid exiting the tank. From there, it flows down through my Y filter and into the pump. Now, the Y filter is always a good idea. This will prevent any debris from making its way into the pump. And when it comes to the location of the pump itself, this is a little wrong. The manual for this pump asks for at least 5 inches of straight piping before the pump inlet, but my 1-inch piping is oversized and I'm really not seeing any issues with starving the pump. After the pump, I've got my flow switch going into my heat exchanger, and coming out of the heat exchanger, I have a valve which will let me keep my tank filled if down the road I need to break the lines to service my pump. And right before going back into the tank, I have another T-fitting and thermowell, which will enable me to get a good temperature reading of the fluid as it re-enters the tank. Back in front of the camera, there's a couple other things I did differently in this build. In my last build, I used yellow Teflon tape and Rector Seal number 5 pipe dope to seal my threaded fittings. And I used that based on what I saw online in terms of material compatibility and other builds. With that sealant in place, I ran my system at room temperature for several weeks and didn't have any leaks. I thought the sealant was going to work great, and then I ran my system at temperature for 3 days, and again, no leaks. But when I disassembled my system, I found that the yellow Teflon tape was really discolored and it looked like it was absorbing some of the fluid. Here's an image showing how the tape looks before and after I used it, and I saw this on pretty much every fitting in my system. Now, I don't know if this would have held up over time, but what I do know is that in general, when plastic starts to change colors and look a little different like this, it's not a good sign. So in this build, I decided to do things a little different. I did a little more research, I surfed the Telegram groups, and I think I found something that might work a little better. In this build, I chose to use Loctite 554 red sealant in all of my threaded fittings. This is one of their red colored sealants, and it's intended for use in situations where you have high temperatures or really nasty chemicals. It's a little thicker than their other red sealants, and so I figured it'd work pretty well. I used it on all my fittings, it was really easy to apply, and after a few weeks, I've had no leaks. Now with this build, I also had a new challenge, and that was to seal the bulkhead fittings going into the tank. I didn't want to use the O-rings that came with the fittings because that O-ring material would get brittle and fall apart with this fluid. I also couldn't use the Loctite material because it just isn't thick enough to fill in these larger gaps. Again, doing a little more research, looking at Telegram groups and other builds, I decided to use red RTV silicone as my sealant. And looking at the DCX fittings from the removed hardware, it looks like they're using the same type of material, so that made me feel that that was a good choice to try here. The particular sealant I used was Dynatech 49292 RTV gasket maker. I put a bead around the fitting where the O-ring was, and I tightened everything into place. And like I said before, I've been running for several weeks at temperature and no leaks. Now, a quick note, if you're going to use either of these sealants in your system, both of these take a long time to cure. Before I ran any fluid in my system, I let everything cure for about 3 days. This is where it really helps to be patient to make sure you have a leak-free design. The other change I made in the rebuild was to use dielectric brake fittings on the glycol water side of my heat exchanger. Again, I'm learning as I go here, and after reading a little more, I realized that mating copper fittings directly to the stainless steel heat exchanger was a really bad idea. Over time, those two metals will set up galvanic corrosion and slowly work their way and create holes in the system, creating leaks. Dielectric fittings have a small piece of plastic which electrically isolate the copper from the stainless steel and prevent that corrosion from taking place. They're fairly cheap, and it's a good measure to make sure your system can run for the long term. With the system rebuilt and resealed, I was ready to refill my tank and my glycol cooling loop and get mining again. But lucky for me, I had one more problem to fix, and that was a small leak in the piping around my mixing valve at the other end of my water glycol cooling loop. This leak had been there since the very first time I ran my system, and I had been avoiding fixing it because it was a very slow leak, it was in a hard to reach location, I had to completely drain the cooling loop to fix it, and it required me to completely disassemble my mixing valve before I could disassemble and resolder that leaking joint. But I'm super glad that I decided to take on this repair, because when I disassembled my mixing valve, I discovered the true source of my overheating problem. Way back when I first filled my system, I skipped the step normally taken when you build a hydronic loop. In fact, I talked about skipping this step in that build video.
After leak checking your system, the next step is to purge your system of dirt and debris. The Kalefi video goes over how this is done, and there's local contractors you can find who will do this for you if you don't have the equipment yourself. Now, for my system, I didn't purge it. My system's not that big. It looked like a big hassle to kind of take this step. I do have a dirt and air separator right before my pump to catch any debris so it doesn't damage my pump. So I didn't do this. It's a bit of a risk, but it's a corner I decided to cut.
Well, cutting that corner came back to bite me really bad. When you buy a radiator, you really don't know how well these things have been cleaned out. Some are going to have dirt or other debris inside them due to their manufacturing processes. Also, there are a lot of soldered pipe fittings around the radiators, and every single one of these can put dirt, flux, copper shavings, and bits of solder into the lines. Now, this would have been fine in a normal cooling loop. Any debris would have flowed around the lines and been caught by my dirt separator right before going into the pump. However, in my design, I had installed a mixing valve to prevent overcooling during the winter months. And in this particular mixing valve design, both inlet gaskets have an integrated screen to prevent debris from clogging up and damaging the internal valve components. And well, these screens did their job. They caught every bit of dirt and debris coming back from the radiators, and when I disassembled the mixing valve, I found both gasket screens plugged completely solid. They weren't letting any fluid through the lines. And so my cooling loop wasn't flowing any fluid through the lines or through the heat exchanger at the immersion tank, and it was these obstructions that were ultimately responsible for my system overheating. The DCX Bitpod system was operating just fine, and if I would have fixed this leak earlier, I would have discovered the true problem and kept the DCX pump and heat exchanger as is and would not have rebuilt the system. Now, with this hindsight, if I were to do this all over again, I would have either done a really good job purging the system, or I would have included additional Y filter before each side of the mixing valve. These filters would have caught most of the dirt and debris and left everything flowing well. Now, with my system operating over the last month or so, I've had to clean out these mixing valve screens twice so far, and after each cleanout, I'm seeing less and less dirt and debris caught in the gasket screens, and after each cleanout, the system runs much longer before it overheats. I think I likely have one or more cleanouts before all the dirt and debris are out of my lines, and at that point, I'll be able to continuously run my miners at full power without overheating. Now, hopefully my little adventure in problem solving here will give you some ideas of how to troubleshoot your system when things aren't working. As I've noted in the past, one of the goals of this channel is to stumble and make mistakes, showing you what sometimes can go wrong. And hopefully by sharing these mistakes, your build will go that much smoother. Okay, so that's all I have for this episode. In the next few episodes, I'm going to cover heating hot water with Bitcoin and showing you my combined home heating and hot water system. Like, subscribe so you don't miss any new episodes coming your way. And with that, bye.